Good morning, it's Tuesday the 23rd of February. So let me confess this straight away. I just know that as I get older, I'm becoming more cynical and grumpy about many things. One example is how I view the way organisations communicate with me. Let me narrow it down even further and talk as church treasurer about my dealings with Methodist Insurance PLC. I must make it clear that on the one occasion I made a claim on behalf of the church, it was dealt with speedily and efficiently. And this is, after all, the reason why the church pays them a large sum of money each year. However, it does seem that this large sum of money also goes towards funding several multi-page newsletters each year, as well as even more frequent email updates. The tone of these does tend towards the self-congratulatory, often expressed in contemporary corporate jargon. The most recent, for example, a bumper 16-page edition, according to the accompanying letter, celebrates the 150th anniversary of the founding of the company and reminds the reader that from its beginnings in gaslit, steam-powered Victorian Britain, it now operates in the high-tech world of computers and IT. Okay, so 150 years of success has to be worth celebrating. And then the back cover is entirely given over to the company logo and a caption which reads, "Thank you for your loyalty and support over the last 150 years. It's our mission to make the next 150 count as much as the first." What does that even mean? Who is the thank you directed towards? Me? Well, I've been loyal insofar as I've paid the premium for about the last 7 years. So do I represent all my predecessors and possible successors? And should I be passing these thanks on to those still around who filled the role before me and whoever may eventually take over from me? Should it perhaps go in the church notices? Or is the whole thing just rhetoric with no meaningful substance? Now, I know I'm being unfair in singling out Methodist Insurance for this criticism. It just so happens that this correspondence arrived a couple of days ago and triggered these thoughts. And there are worse offenders, believe me. Like you, no doubt, I've sat on the end of a telephone for half an hour waiting to speak to someone whilst at intervals in the Muzak being told how important my call is to the organisation. It does seem that we suffer from an epidemic of hyperbole, nourished no doubt by the multi-billion pound UK advertising industry and expressing itself in over-promising, feigned feel-good sincerity and smooth talking. And we become so used to it that it becomes the norm. Maybe we should turn more often to the scriptures for a reality check. In Matthew 5, as part of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus cautions against extravagant oaths or promises. "Just say yes or no," he urges. "Anything further is from the evil one." And even in the early church, it seems that some were not above tweaking the truth to their own advantage. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul warns, "Unlike so many, we do not peddle the word of God for profit. On the contrary, in Christ we speak before God with sincerity as those sent from God." The biblical writers are united in their commitment to unembellished truth-telling, whether or not it is palatable to the readers and hearers. For ultimately, it is only through truth that freedom comes, as Jesus makes clear in John chapter 8. And as Tom Wright comments on that passage, the way to freedom is through the truth, and what matters therefore is to know the truth. Tyranny and slavery of every sort thrive on lies, half-truths, evasions and cover-ups. Freedom and truth go hand in hand. These are undoubtedly words which need to be heard in our time. We need to pay attention to them as individuals, and we need to call to account our institutions when we see them tipping over into anything other than straightforward truth-telling. In this consumer age, when so many media and products and indeed good causes clamour for our attention, this is a big ask. We're familiar with the phrase that truth is the first casualty of war, and though we may not like to think of our lives as warfare, the call to stand for truth is inescapable for a Christian disciple. And truth is not some disembodied principle. Truth is what is seen and lived in the life of Jesus Christ. So let us pray. Lord, I'm not beyond tweaking the truth when it suits me. Forgive me and help me to keep focused on Jesus in my words and in my actions, for he is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen.